So the aim of my paper is very modest aim, is to consider the fragments of the Yale Codex from the point of view of late antique epigraphy. When the organizers kindly but firmly invited me to compare the new poems to metrical inscriptions of the 4th century, I accepted without any hesitation. I was maybe too optimistic, as we will see, because comparison, if we intend comparison on the level on intertextual relationships, we will be disappointed. But I think that anyway there are some points of contact between the Yale papyrus and late inscriptions. And first of all, a fact already remarked in the Editio Princeps by Kevin, the mise-en-page of the codex. And the systematic presence of paratextual signs, which remind of both similar layouts on stone and the development of the disposition of elegiac couplets we are familiar with in medieval manuscripts. In the handout, point 1.1, you have a quotation from Jean Riguin's well-known article on this problem. So, the first part of my talk will be devoted to a comparison of the layout of the codex with that of late antique inscriptions, and I'll try also to put into a wider context the question of clustering of epigrams. In the second part, I'll deal with the content of the codex, especially the Scoptic epigrams, trying to compare it to contemporary inscriptions. Just a word on contemporary. I will deal with inscriptions from the end of the 3rd century until to the beginning of the 5th. Sometimes, as you know, metrical inscriptions are very difficult to date. And in any case, from the 3rd century onwards, the epigraphic habits, at least in the East, part of the empire is quite uniform, if I may say that. To be honest, and as I was saying, a comparison with the inscription will result a little bit disappointing if we look for intertextual parallels or texts elucidating the scanty remains of the codex, even though we can cast some new light on this ground too. But the same comparison on a more general level is helpful indeed, pointing out that the epigrams of the codex represent a literary counterpart of subjects and themes exploited in inscriptional poems. In a word, comparison reminds us that in late antiquity, inscriptional and literary poetry are part of the same cultural and social system and they cannot be separated, as scholars of highbrow literature usually do. One of the distinctive features of the layout in the Yale Codex is the indentation of pentameters. It's an arrangement which has its origins, point 1.2 on your handout, in Roman inscriptions, as it has been plausibly demonstrated by Alfredo Morelli, and which is rare in early papyri, becoming relatively more frequent from the end of the Hellenistic Age onwards. There are many well-known examples, just I've chosen celebrated Gallus Papyrus. For what concerns us today, it is important to remind that this arrangement is more attested in inscriptions than in papyri, and moreover, that it is increasingly attested in late antique inscriptions, where here you find some example from Hellenistic, late Hellenistic, Imperial Age. These are painted epigrams. In late antiquity, we have also this curious phenomenon of a false couplet, For example, you see the second part of the pentameter is indented also in this inscription, and in this inscription from Syria, the second part of the hexameter, this is a sticky hexameter inscription, the second part is intended, just indented, just to give the impression that it is a couplet, but it's a false couplet. The mutual influence between inscriptions and book production, stone epigrams imitating books and vice versa, already recognized by Wilhelm, Louis Robert and others, point 1-3 of your handout, continues late antiquity, when it's not infrequent to find inscriptions arranged like book. A nice example, one of my favorite, is an inscription composed by the Empress Eudocia, arranged in two columns as a book, as you can see. Dated to the mid of the 5th century. Yet, our codex, with its systematically indented pentameters, remains somewhat exceptional in book production, according to the extant evidence. As a comparison, we can look at the layout of the elegiacs in Thibaudomer 31, end of the 4th, beginning of the 5th century, where pentameters are aligned with hexameters. Nonetheless, putting together the Yale Codex and epigraphic examples, we can affirm that in late antiquity, indenting pentameters, or offsetting hexameters, was more widespread than usually supposed. And let me add also that epigraphic data are assuredly underrepresented, since editions are far from being accurate in this respect, as the control, when possible, on images reveals. So, just to give you a very preliminary conclusion, one presumably supposes that epigram pattern books circulating among workshops to be used and adapted to customers' requests had the same mise en page of the verses we see in the Yale Codex. And the Yale Codex, for an epigraphist, is a very important source of comparison witness. This is confirmed by paratextual indications, especially titles and headings. In his introduction, Kevin offered a detailed analysis of them, so I limit myself to adduce some epigraphic evidence. As for titles, it's interesting just to take a look at the new painted epigrams, to the right in red, from Trimitis, that were intended as a model for students, once again reproducing book patterns, in my opinion. Here you can see the red arrow, there is a title, S. Istus Scholasticus. Prose titles are rare in late papyri. A remarkable exception is the sequence of hexameter poems, etopoeae, on mythological subjects, each one preceded by a prose title and separated by a long paragraphus, sometimes stretching to the end of a line. Is a Heidelberg papyrus to be dated to the 5th-6th century AD. More familiar is the presence of the heading Allo. It's well known from Gauss' pivotal book on sources and descriptions of the Greek anthology how rare are the headings Allo and Omoios, as we have in our papyrus, in the Palatine manuscript. As far as I know, the union of both headings, Allo Moios, is not attested elsewhere, as well as the puzzling plural Alla, twice in the Codex and once or twice in the Palatine manuscript. The state of the Codex is not helpful in understanding the meaning of them in each occurrence, but it seems reasonable to infer that they were intended to mark epigrams similar in content, maybe very similar in case Omoios is added. I actually don't know. In the Yale epigram, in the Yale Codex, headings mark groupings of epigrams by subject matters. Point 1.7 on your handout. The system of clustering companion epigrams to be read in sequence and not isolated, even responding each other, is well attested in inscriptions from the classical age, even though only in the imperial period we find double or triple epigrams practicing the Hellenistic art of variation, as demonstrated by Marco Fantuzzi in some recent articles. In the following images, you have examples randomly chosen to cover different geographical areas, just to show you how widespread is the phenomenon, from aphrodisias to honorific epigrams for Pollyon, from Athens, an epigram in honor of Plutarchus, the Neoplatonic philosopher, 4th century, from Lycia, and this is a double epigram on the two sides of the stones. In all, which is important, in all these examples, the epigrams are separated just by a wacat, a blank space. In other cases, there is no separation at all. This is a nice example coming from Milan, a triple funerary epigram, clearly distinguished by internal signs, entade, the repetition of the etru, etc., but there is no evidence, no physical evidence of the separation apart the beginning of the new line, as you can see. The same system is adopted in the Kelly's Wooden Codex, 4th century, where there is no clear indication that a new epigram is beginning if this codex, if we are dealing with two different epigrams, which is far evident. In other cases, in late antique inscriptions, epigrams are separated by other signs, for example, this magnificent little cycle of epigrams on Faustina's bath from Miletus. The epigrams are separated by Eftikos, Evacat, and Eftikos. And in the first epigrams, as you can see, pentameters are indented too. Quite relevant is the amount of companion pieces separated by allo in late antique inscriptions. Taking into consideration only examples with three or more epigrams, it's easy to follow the presence of this typology from the Hellenistic age again. This is a beautiful example coming from Egypt, up to late antiquity. Very recently, this is an example of the 4th century. Turkey, the epigrams are separated by allos. A nice example has been recently edited from Maga, Syria, three funerary epigrams for a certain Avitus, which are where the pentameters are indented and the epigrams are separated by Heteron epigramma, which is quite rare as a heading. Interesting enough, even later, this way of separating epigrams was perceived as typically inscriptional, if I may say that. We can see it in this beautiful round medallion coming from a 9th century manuscript in Florence, Laurentia, Biblioteca Laurenziana, Conventus of Press 202, in Epigraphische Auszeichnungs Majuskel, where the epigrams are separated by allo in red ink. And the epigrams are not Byzantine but late antique, I'm pretty sure, because the style is typical of late antique poems. As for the content, the poor state of preservation of the codex makes any attempt to compare it with descriptions highly speculative. Nonetheless, some features can be usually compared with metrical inscriptions. First of all, politics, a subject that seems dominating in pages 9 to 13 of the codex. The presence of poems against local politicians is not surprising, of course. If the poems are by Palladas, as it seems, they confirm that the poet was involved in local politics far beyond Alexandrian civic community. Maybe a young Palladas, as yesterday Alan suggested. If they belong to another poet or other poets, they confirm how satire and invective was common in Egyptian society. Generally speaking, satire and lampoons against politicians are the other side of honorific verse inscriptions for governors, which are one of the most characteristic features of late antique society. The Yale Codex, from this point of view, confirms an intuition by Louis Aubert, which realized already in his wonderful book on late epigrams, that Palladas political poems are helpful to clarify official metrical inscriptions. You have the quotation in point 2.1 of your handout. I'm pretty sure if we had something more than scanty remains of the new epigrams, this aspect would be even more evident. For example, point 2.2 of your handout, at page 6, the presence of Adorolochos suggests to interpret these remains as an epigram about a governor. If Aristides is not a personal name, his mention might address to the same direction, since Aristides was one of the models to be mentioned in order to extol the equity of the governor according to Menander the Rhetor. You have the quotation in the right column. Encomiastic language and the habits could explain also the puzzling epigram at page 5, number 2-3 of your handout. Remains of a 10-line poem on a certain night in Sobermopolis, probably a local evildoer and criminal, as Wilkinson pointed out in his commentary. Kevin observes also that in line 20 to 24, the poet presumably is playing with a hymnic structure, and that the pun on Nilus could refer to Hermopolitan realien, like a festival of the night. I wonder, just a suggestion, if the pun is rather on acclamations, that say the formula is shouted by an assembly or a gathering of people to honor emperors, governors, and also prominent citizens and benefactors. Well, acclamations are well attested in inscriptions, especially from Aphrodisias, for example, but it's interesting that Nilus was one of the epithets used to honor a benefactor, as a well-known passage of John Chrysostom's homily on vainglory shows, point 2.3. The predominance of political subjects shouldn't make us forget that it's not impossible that the Codex included other literary genres. For instance, the bad state of preservation doesn't allow to well understand this point 2.4 to 2.5 of your handout. How Phaeton's myth was used at page 16. But I think that we should consider the possibility that here we are dealing with a funerary poem. Phaeton's story was very popular, for example, in iconography, and we also know some example of its use as a paradigm for sorrow. In a curious inscription from Palestine, to be dated to the 5th or 6th century, Phaeton is just a synonym of a young, prematurely died. We have the text in the right column. It's also interesting to consider, albeit briefly, the length of our epigrams. According to Wilkinson's data, in the Codex, epigrams of more than 10 lines are relatively rare, but there is a significant presence of quite long poems up to 32 lines. Even taking into account a degree of uncertainty, it seems reasonable to speak of a tendency towards epigrammata longa. In itself, this is not surprising at all, since it is a general tendency of late antique epigrams and especially of inscriptional poems. There is a significant number of long dedicatory epigrams and of epigrams celebrating governors dating to the 4th and 5th century AD. A nice example we have in the handout is a long 20-line hexametric inscription from Patras in honor of a local benefactor, which represents also the standard style and language of this kind of honorific inscriptions with allusions to with mythological definitions, poetical periphrases for technical terms, etc., etc. The Yale Codex probably reflects a change of taste and the moment when inscribed and literary epigrams became closer in this respect. Later, things changed, as you know, and brevity became a criterion of selecting texts, whereas in inscriptions we find long and even very long epigrams up to the Byzantine Middle Ages. Interesting enough, of the two known epigrams at page 21 and 20 and 12 in the Codex, the latter is longer in the Yale Codex than in the Palatine Anthology. Point. No doubt that the four verses transmitted in the Greek Anthology have been selected because of their gnomic content. The same phenomenon we can observe in stone epigrams. Just to offer you an example, these are two epigrams from Aphrodisias, from Asclepiodotus, the philosophers, of which only the latter is preserved in the Greek Anthology. We have a text at point 3.2 of your handout. In this case, it's rather the stylistic quality or the second epigram which I think may explain its survival. Gnomic character, on the contrary, just to quote a Palladan case, is the reason why a couplet attributed to Palladas by part of the tradition, AP 1058, Gesse Peben, Gisse Epebin Gymnos Hypogean Apimi, is found in an icon belonging to a Byzantine funerary monument from Lycia. One word on variants, point 4 of your handout. It's curious that in both known epigrams there are variant readings, and in one case the variant of the Yale Codex is superior to the Greek Anthology text. Once again, it's a well-known phenomenon for inscriptions, but it would be interesting to remind that a couple of variants is attested also in another epigram by Palladas, surely by Palladas, transmitted inscriptionally, is the point 4.1 of your handout. It is an iambic epigram inscribed on a 4th century toilet wall in Ephesus in a rather different form, as you can see. If the variant reading at line 1 is less effective and more natural, the substitution of line 2 was maybe intentional to adapt the epigram to its new destination. But it's also possible that Palladas actually took inspiration from an epigram by a famous reputed poet that was also inscribed in Ephesus, as Alan Cameron argued some decades ago. I go to very briefly to the conclusion. The Yale Codex represents a local product conceived for an Egyptian audience, and the epigrams are topical, as the references to Upper Egypt and to specific people clearly show. It's probably because of this topicality that later anthologists got interested in these verses. a later interest for local poets and for local events is not surprising. If we think of the anthology of 4th century Egyptian poets, Photius was still able to read the Bibliotheci Codex 279. Or of the considerable number of metrical inscriptions coming from Smyrna, present in Book 9 of the Greek Anthology, for which it has been supposed the existence of a local syllogy already used by Agapias or later by Gregory of Kamsa. Despite the apparently promising topicality of the epigrams in the Yale Codex, the comparison with Egyptian metrical inscriptions, I repeat, most of which are funerary poems, is not particularly exciting. I must confess I didn't find any significant textual relationship between the new epigrams and inscriptions from Hermopolis, for example. As for the content, apart from Palladian subjects as poverty, old age, or philosophy, the most characteristic feature is local politics, as we have seen. Even in case that not all the epigrams were by Palladas, their importance wouldn't be affected. There were other satirical poets, as for example the Nicander, stigmatized by Palladas himself as selling iambic verses as a shopman sells oil. Not only satire and sceptic poems, but even parody, literary parody, was widespread in Egypt, as the Kelly Wooden Codex, which contains also a possible parody of Christian concepts, as recently shown. The Yale Codex gives further evidence of how much in the 4th century people were inclined to invective. It's a general feature of the literary production of the century, directly proportional to the encomiastic and celebrative language, and that is overspread in every literary genre. I studied it some years ago, working on a late antique Yambiche idea, and recently the problem has been analyzed by Raffaella Crivioli in her recent book on Libanius. It is tempting, so, to associate this anthology to a renaissance of sceptic epigram in the 4th century, as Wilkinson argued. As far as this idea might seem attractive, if we consider inscriptional poetry, we realize that it is more difficult to speak of a break in epigrammatic production from imperial period to late antiquity. Therefore, it's not necessary, in my view, to think to a publication of a new anthology to explain the flowering of interest in Greek epigram in the second half of the 4th century. Yet, the idea of a renewal of interest in sceptic poetry can be accepted, in my view, only if we speak of a change of taste, or better, of a sort of a reaction. It is not coincidental that, with the flourishing of official encomiastic epigrams on stone, literary poets assumed the task of representing, chiefly on a less grand support, be it a poetry book or a papyrus scrap, an alternative voice. Yale Codex helps us to better understand the literary historical framework and to imagine what we have lost, just like in recent years the publication of the Bodmer Codex of Visions, the Codex Visionum, changed our view of Greek Christian poetry in the mid-4th century. Thank you.